Perfect. Hello and good afternoon to all of you around the world from Vienna. My name is Sophie and I'm from the Visit Education Center in Austria. Today I have the honor to welcome you in the name of the whole Visit team to this webinar with Professor Sadao Sato. This webinar is going to be held in English language, but there is also simultaneous translation into Spanish language and Russian language. You can choose your language by clicking on the interpretation icon in your Zoom window and select the language you want to listen to. Today, I also want to take the opportunity to thank all our lecturers in the name of the Visit team who make this possible, all this webinar series. Also, a big thank you to Professor Sadao Sato, who is in Tokyo right now, for giving this great lecture today. And also a special thanks to our translators, Diana Babredin, who is in Paris, and Yasmin Gattoni, who is in Paraguay. Thank you very much. So today, during this webinar, you're all attendees. This means that your video and sound function is disabled. But you still can ask questions with the Q&A function. This feature you will find in the lower task panel of your Zoom window. Please ask all questions in English language, because Professor Sadao Sato will answer some selected questions live after his lecture. All the other questions are going to be answered within the next couple of days and will then be uploaded to our Visit homepage. I will now transfer the screen to Professor Sadao Sato, and I hope that all of you are going to enjoy this webinar.
Ja, okay. So. Okay, so I'm ready to start my lecture. Is it okay? Everybody okay? Can you hear?
Yes, everything is fine, Professor Sato.
Okay.
You can start. Thank you.
Good. Yeah, today's subject of my talk is I changed a little bit this title, but anyway, the orthodontics and the TMD patient. This is my subject to talk, okay? Now this is a very important because we have so many TMD patient. But, you know, in order to treat the TMD patient, we should understand the why so many malocclusions and how the different types of the malocclusion develop, and what is the this is actually a very basic question. What is the malocclusion? We should understand all these, then try to approach the TMD patient. First of all, I'd like to talk a little bit about some etiological aspect for malocclusion. Okay, if you look at the very short history of craniofacial biology, there were the big paradigm shift, especially the mandibular growth or condylar growth the 100 years ago, everybody believed all the skeletal tissue are basically genetically predetermined. That's why we cannot change the facial growth or mandibular growth, especially the condylar growth, we cannot control. This was 100 years ago, everybody believed. But now, especially in 1970s, mandibular condyle is slowly changing the idea, because so many research people approach to check the condylar growth. Then 1970 to 1980s, we found so many evidence the condyle is actually very much adaptable organ. Then the change, the paradigm, now we can understand the craniofacial complex is highly adaptable tissues. Especially condyle, even condyle is very much adaptable tissue organ. This kind of big paradigm shift occur about 50 years ago. Then we changed the concept. This is one of the basic research. The 1975, Lee Graeber published one paper. He tried to measure the condylar growth. The two conditions, the one is loaded condyle, the another one is unloaded condyle. So you can see here, loaded condyle, in other words, compressed condyle cannot grow. But unloaded condyle very nicely growing. Therefore, the traditional concept explained about the condylar growth is the inside of the condyle, there's something growth center here, then intrinsic factor promote condylar growth. Then secondary, the mandibular position change. This was a traditional concept. But after 1970s, we changed. The first step, the mandibular position change, this provide a unloaded situation of the condyle, then secondary condyle can grow. This is a current concept of mandibular growth or condylar growth. Therefore, now we can use this principle in our orthodontic patient. Okay. So if you see the human facial growth, see the newborn baby, their occlusal plane is very steep and the vertical dimension is very poor vertical dimension. Okay, the occlusal plane goes through the condyle, but slowly milk teeth are erupting, then slowly changing occlusal plane, That means increasing vertical dimension here. And continuously, occlusal plane is changed. Then finally, the pretty flat occlusal plane established. Yeah. Therefore, the distance between condyle and the occlusal plane, this distance is increased. Yeah. So this kind of human facial growth, this is a principle of facial growth. Then in human facial growth, it is very important the vertical growth, vertical dimension increase, and the occlusal plane change. This is a very, very important factor. Okay? And then from this kind of point of view, the different malocclusion group, here you can see the normal growth, that means a class 1 growth subject, and the class 2 and the class 3. The class 1 subject, they are the occlusal plane is slowly changing, then slowly flattening of occlusal plane. The mandible, mandible is rotate forward. Yeah, that, therefore the mandibular plane angle also slowly decreasing. I mean, mandibular plane angle is decreasing. This is normal growing, but if you look at class 2, this is a class 2 high angle subject. Their occlusal plane not so much flattening, especially 9, 10 years old. Then almost this part of the posterior part of occlusal plane no change. Therefore, slowly occlusal plane going to be steep. And this kind of occlusal plane, the mandible cannot adapt the forward position. Mandible is easily backward rotation. Yeah. Therefore, slowly more and more high angle type of facial pattern established. But if you see class 3 subject, this group of malocclusion showed very much flattening occlusal plane. That means especially posterior part of particle dimension is increased. The mandible is very much rotate forward. Yeah. So that's why mandibular plane angle is very much decreased. Yeah. Then maybe a secondary condyle, always condyle is unloading during this kind of adaptation. Then a condyle can secondary can grow. And this is a class 3 development. Okay. We have to understand this kind of malocclusion development. This is very important to treat the malocclusion patient. Then we developed many different types of the faces, the high angle case or low angle case. This is possible. So this way, our face showed the very much wide wide variation of our skeletal frame, from class 3, skeletal class 3 to skeletal class 2. Yeah. If you compare with primate, the primate face showed not so much variation. But our face showed very wide variation. Yeah, this is depends on how much increase vertical dimension and how mandible adapt to this vertical dimension and the occlusal plane. Yeah, this is the human population showed, about half of population, the class one. This is the Japanese data, but so many class two skeletal patient. The European subjects data showed more than half of European population showed class two skeletal. Yeah. So if you see the primate skull, has very nice mechanisms for the maintaining mandibular position. They have a very strong canine interdigitation here, and also behind of the condyle, they have a very strong bony support here. So these two factors contribute to keep their mandibular position. Therefore, they have not so many class two, class three face. Yeah. And also their occlusal plane and upper and lower teeth interdigitation is very stable, class one occlusion, and the occlusal plane is very flat. In other words, this occlusal plane provide a nice occlusal support. Yeah. So all these elements contribute to keep their mandibular position. Yeah. But this is our human skull showed we lost this number one canine interdigitation and post-glenoid bony support, we lost. Yeah. Therefore, therefore, now it is very, very critical to keep the occlusal plane and the vertical dimension. Again, the occlusion support is very, very important to keep mandibular position. Yeah, because if we lost the occlusal support, very easily mandible displaced backward or laterally or wherever, easily displaced. Then this causes the joint problems. This is our problem. This is a class one skull. Their occlusal plane is developing originally newborn baby showed very steep occlusal plane. Slowly, the posterior vertical dimension increase, and slowly flattening occlusal plane, they always mandible adapt forward position by rotation. Therefore, always joint is unloading situation. Then secondary condyle can grow. This is a normal growing processes. But if you see the class 2 skull, this is a very typical class 2 patient. Yeah. Their occlusal plane, especially I want to say posterior part of occlusal plane, is very steep. Yeah. That means not enough occlusal support. That's why if you look at the joint, their condyle is always something flattening and no space between the fossa and the condyle. That means very strong compression here. Yeah, this is a big problem. Yeah. Once again, this is a class 2 skull and very steep posterior occlusal plane. That means not enough vertical dimension. Then strong compression here. Yeah, all these causes big dysfunction problem. Yeah. So, and also we have a problem. Now if you look at milk dentition in primate and human, if you compare their occlusion, milk dentition, you know, milk dentition, the primate showed already class 1 type of occlusion here. The major step type of the terminal plane. Only human milk dentition, we have a class 2 up and lower tooth relation. So this is one of the another problem of human growth, because our mandible have to adapt forward position, otherwise impossible to establish the class 1 occlusion or class 1 skeletal frame. Yeah. So this is a newborn situation of our skull. Yeah. Our baby start growing from something like this. Okay. The originally skeletally pretty severe class 2 relation and the poor vertical dimension and the steep occlusal plane. Yeah, and no DPO. No DPO means, once again, distance between condyle and occlusal plane, this is zero, right? So this is our starting point, and slowly growing. So all these growing processes are actually adaptation processes, right? So then our face showed something 10% prognathic mandible, and some subject showed retrognathic mandible. Yeah, this kind of different types of faith develop. But the human facial growth, fortunately, this is very slowly developed. Therefore, the functional point of view, the many subjects establish the normal function, U function. Yeah, this is because the slowly develop the skeletal. That's why you know, we can establish the normal function. But some people, some subjects develop this dysfunction problem. Yeah. This is a very critical. Yeah. Therefore, we have morphologically, we have many eugnathia subject. That means a class one subject. The many class one subject develop the normal function. Even some dysgnathia patient, class 2, 3, MLD, high angle, low angle, whatever. But pretty many dysgnathia patient also develop the functionally no problem, healthy function. So this kind of subject, the treatment is not necessary. The problem is dysgnathia patient or eugnathia subject sometimes develops the dysfunction problem. Now this is a big problem. This kind of subject, we are sure it is necessary to treat this patient. From this kind of point of view, it is very, very important to make a functional diagnosis. And because this kind of patient, we need a therapeutic position of the mandible. This is the most important part of our diagnostic processes. What is a TMD? Well, TMD is this is also 40, more than 40 years ago, the Dr. Farah, he published two papers about internal derangement of TM joint. Then he explained, it was a long time ago, in his publication, he explained the normal type of the joint movement, and early opening click patient or intermediate opening click patient, their condyle move like this. Late opening click, complete anterior dislocation of the disc patient, he already explained all these functional problem. Yeah. So, this is also his paper showing the Kundera movement of TMD patient. Not only that, but also he explained also, you know, pain, you know, the many, many places showing some pain, ear pain, joint pain, something like this. There are another symptoms. And also he explained something, cardiac arrhythmia, or, you know, indigestion, stress reaction, all these explained 40 years ago. All these symptoms are related with the temporomandibular joint dysfunction. Yeah. And he also explaining the development of internal derangement, yeah, something like this. But anyway, he explained first step, capsulitis. This is the starting point. Then start clicking and some acute rock and chronic rock. Then finally, osteoarthritic problem. Yeah, this is the development of TMD. Now we are understanding all this situation. So from this kind of point of view, the mandibular position, I mean, diagnosis for mandibular position is the most important subject in our diagnosis. The centric relation, you know, everybody know, this is a definition of the centric relation. The centric relation, this definition explained the eminence and disc and condyle, all these three parts of the joint are normally related. Yeah, this is a centric relation. This is good, but as you know, this kind of situation, even condyle moved, always showed the eminence, disc, condyle, normal relation. Therefore, this is a centric relation. But actually, our patient, many patients showed this kind of problem. No more centric relation. Yeah? Disc is already displaced. The condyle is displaced. Now this is, the big problem, functional problem. So, therefore we need some correct approach to this patient. Then long time ago, also Professor Slavček proposed his idea, the RP. This is a really nice idea. He proposed a RP position for the diagnosis. So we are using RP. RP is defined as a controlled littoral border of the mandible in which the tissues of the joint are not loaded. So this position we can use as a diagnostic zero position. Yeah. Then start the diagnosis. So the RP position, RP is a diagnostic zero position of the TM joint regardless to its functional condition. From this diagnostic zero, the other position can be defined. In order to do a diagnosis, we need some zero position of the mandible or condyle. So therefore, concept of RP is something like this. We have to make a diagnosis. This particular patient, the joint situation is physiological position of the condyle or deranged position. We call this the PRP or DRP. If we make a diagnosis, if patient position is DRP, we have to find out the therapeutic position. In some case, especially in orthodontics, class 2 skeletal patient, even still RP is not real DRP, but still we need this kind of patient, the new position of the condyle. Once again, the especially class 2 patient, the many cases, I like to find out the new position of the mandible, usually forward position. Then start the treatment. Okay. So let's talk about the development of the internal derangement. Okay. Anyway, it is very important the condylar position and the disc situation. If this relation is everything okay, now this is the normal situation. But slowly, if condyle is displaced, if condyle displaced, the slowly disc condyle relation is changed. This is the initial stage, the little bit disc displaced. This is the stage one, the painless clicking and unrestricted mandibular motion. Then if condyle is displaced more backward or laterally displaced, then now this is stage two, the occasional painful clicking and internal locking and the headache. The headache starts from stage two. Then stage three, the more the condyle is displaced. Of course, articular disc also displaced. Yeah. Now, this is a frequent joint pain and tenderness, headaches, locking, and restricted range of mandibular motion, as well as painful chewing. This kind of problem start. So, but until stage three, still this disc displacement with reduction. The last part of stage three now start a little bit difficult to the disc reduction. But still bony, bone morphology, condylar morphology still okay. Then stage four, now problem start, the bony, morphological change of the condyle. Maybe strong compression, then condyle start resorption or, deform, and the flattening of the condyle start. And finally, stage five, more condyle morphology change, the severe flattening of the condyle. Of course, disc is displaced without reduction, already deformed the disc. So this kind of situation, we say, the osteoarthrosis. Yeah, this is a big problem. So, a long time ago, Zarf and Carlson explained this osteoarthrosis may be a final common pathway for several joint conditions. Yeah. This is the final common situation of the joint. So then the long time, the published paper, so many paper published, TM joint pain dysfunction patient, 71%, this paper 59%, another paper 53%, the Weinberg's 83 paper said 90% of TMJ pain dysfunction patient showed the posteriorly displaced condyle. Yeah. Therefore, in order to treat TMD patient, the repositioning condyle is one of the most important approach to treat. Well, another paper showed also, this is an orthodontic patient. Dr. Owen he's an orthodontist. The orthodontic patient, if we check, look here, over 17 years old, the orthodontic patient, 76% of our patient showed joint problem, and the majority of this group showed posteriorly displaced condyle. this is the big problem, chondral displacement. Or another paper, published, showing the chondral displacement or class two problem. This is basically the TMD, the problem. The class two group showed more and more this kind of symptom. This is Henriksson's paper showed the class two group significantly high frequency of the headache or creaking, all these joint problems. So, once again, I'd like to emphasize that, if we compare the primate and our skull, we lost the most important element to keep mandibular position. We lost the now only vertical dimension and up and lower teeth interdigitation keep the mandibular position. Yeah, this is critical. Yeah. So the idea of the craniomandibular system, we have many, the condyle, bony, cartilage, tissue, disc, and the ligament, lateral articular connective tissue, all these craniomandibular system try to keep the mandible and the condylar position in rather forward position. If the mandible displaced, this makes a big problem anyway. So this is the Slavchek's data. This not only lateral pterygoid muscle, but also some part of the temporal muscle, masseter muscle, going into the condyle and the disc, then to keep the condylar position rather forward position. This way, the mandibular position, this craniomandibular system, especially the muscles of craniomandibular system, try to keep the mandible the forward position. The craniomandibular system is a system which maintains the mandible forward position, problem occur, for example, too steep guidance anterior part or occlusal loss of the occlusal support, or these kind of occlusion factors causes the mandibular displacement, then the craniomandibular system want to keep condylar position forward, but the many patients showed pretty easily the mandible displaced backward. So Therefore, I think such a patient, the repositioning therapy is necessary and a very important approach. Therefore, also the orthodontic treatment is now very, very important. Okay, once again, during the all these facial growth, the mandible is always rotationally coming forward. Please keep in mind this. That's why the orthodontists have to think about the mandibular repositioning therapy, that we can use this kind of principle in our treatment approach. So, therefore, benefit of orthodontic treatment in PMD patient, I think the repositioning the mandible forward position by control of occlusal plane, vertical dimension, and retrusive guidance, and the providing occlusal support by uprighting buccal segment. It's a very nice unloading the joint. Therefore, this is this two element, two benefit we should use in our orthodontic treatment. Now let me show you a typical case. This young lady, 13 years old female patient. Her problem was this kind of occlusion. A little bit crowding. But her problem is, if you look at the buccal segment here, the too much forward inclination of all this buccal segment. This kind of occlusion, she lost the occlusal support. Therefore, in the chondrograph, you can see easily the protrusion, retrusion, open, close movement. Her right side of condyle cannot move. Only one to two millimeter move. But anyway, the closed lock situation, the medial occlusion right also only two, three millimeter move. So the problem is, this is a CPM. The RPICP, you can see here, right side, both sides, her condyle is the strong compression, especially the RP forced bite position showed, anyway, the strong compression. This kind of patient, it is very clear the treatment approach should be providing occlusion support, unloading joint. This is our purpose to treat. Well, joint MRI showed, sorry, this is a little dark, but the right side, disc displacement without reduction, yeah? and left side, disk displacement with reduction. So, therefore, this kind orthodontic approach is not complicated. The purpose is all these majorly inclined buccal segment that we have to apply it. If we apply it, this makes a nice occlusion support, the unloading joint. Usually this kind of approach, I use this kind of device, and 4 months later, the up and lower multi-loop, then use vertical elastic here. Slowly all the buccal segment uprighting. If you success this uprighting during the treatment, the right side of the joint start movement. Protrusion, retrusion, open close movement, no limitation now. Very nice movement. But this condyle movement showed the delta Y shift. This is necessary to start opening. Then continue this kind of treatment, still uprighting. Yeah, this is what I did. Is only uprighting all the buccal segment. Yeah, of course, sorry, I didn't mention this case, the lower third molar and the upper second molar extraction before start treatment. Anyway, the finish like this. This is maybe clear, this kind of interdigitation showed the nice occlusion support. Yeah. Then after orthodontic treatment, again chondrograph. Anyway, no limitation. Before treatment, the open close movement only 1-2 millimeter movement, but now no limitation, and delta Y shift still here, but very much reduced. And CPM showed the no compression here. Even the clenching situation, the no compression. Well, this is good. This is 1.5 years later. This kind of occlusion showed pretty stable. Okay, and superimposition showed a little bit the mandibular repositioning. Good. After treatment, the joint MRI, still disc is displaced. Not reduction, but partially, I think, partially reduction of disc displacement. So this is the retrospective analysis of her joint situation. This is a before treatment. Maybe her condyle, right side of the condyle, displaced to the right side. Therefore, disc displaced maybe anteromedially displaced, and the condyle stuck between ligament and the disc. Therefore, closed the rock. Yeah, this is the reason why her right side of the condyle couldn't move, close the rock. But during orthodontic treatment, slowly, you know, unloading treatment success, because uprighting buccal segment, then start movement, because this disc, condyle, ligament situation change, then start movement. Initially, the big delta Y shift, this was necessary, but after treatment, this delta Y is reduced. The more, you know, all this relation changed, now functionally or movement, no problem. Something like this. Okay. This 27 years old lady, she had a joint problem, pain and the creaking, headache, cervical tension, shoulder stiffness, this kind of problem. Quickly, I like to show you. So this kind of occlusion, you know, the too much upper front, you know, the guidance steep, too steep. Therefore, her mandible was displaced the backward. This is also common problem in class 2 case. And her lower left side tooth number 5 previously removed. Therefore, one premolar missing. This is a cephalometric analysis, and the occlusal plane is too steep, and the joint is creaking. You can see here the upper front is crazy, crazy steep guidance. But this case diagnosed as a malocclusion with a craniomandibular dysfunction due to a posteriorly displaced mandible. The therapeutic position of the mandible was estimated to 3 millimeters forward from reference position. Then our plan was orthodontically the open upper arch, then secondary prosthodontic reconstruction. The upper front flaring out, then enlarge upper arch, then change occlusal plane, then mandibular repositioning, and this kind of treatment approach. The leveling. This is a very simple leveling and multi-loop. Also uprighting. okay, then nicely applied it, then finish orthodontic treatment, then after that, the prosthodontic reconstruction. Yeah, this is the before and after. This is superimposition. Maybe you can see the mandibular repositioning. Then now no clicking, no limitation of the condylar movement. Something, this is still temporary, but I started the prosthodontic approach. So if you see the mandibular reposition of the mandible provides a very nice relaxed type of the profile now. Yeah, okay. This is a before and after. This is another case, 29 years old male patient. He had a problem of his mandible is deviated to the right side. Yeah, therefore his main concern was lower face deviation, headache, the deep eyeball pain, neck shoulder stiffness, back pain. Yeah, the palpation showed the temporal masseter trapezius muscle pain and the right side quick clicking and the sometime pain. This kind of problem very low angle type of class 2 face, the lower facial height only 39. Yeah. Mandibular deviation to the right side. So his chondrograph showed the big clicking here, right side, and the phonetic position is very much forward position. The medial occlusion right showed also big clicking here. And this is open close. Of course, it is very important that his RP position is PRP or DRP. It is no doubt the DRP. Therefore, we have to find out his TRP, a therapeutic position. Then finally, I decided here, right side, 6 millimeter forward position. Just before the closing clicking point, and the left side, 1.5 millimeter forward position. This is his ICP position and the therapeutic position on the articulator. The intraoral photo also showed somewhere here is should be his therapeutic position. Then orthodontic approach started, and this way mainly applying treatment again, and 10 months later all these metal crown private, but you know, little problem, up and down. Therefore, at this point, I remove all these metal crowns, then change to a temporary acrylic crown, then continue orthodontic treatment. Yeah, this is after orthodontic treatment. This midline is not coincide because if his mandible going back to little bit to the right side, again clicking start. Therefore, I decided that this position should be the final position. Well, before and after orthodontics, after that, we started temporary crown, the waxing, then temporary crown here. This case, I didn't use any retention appliance. Actually, this temporary crown is a kind of retainer. So this is before and after superimposition. You can see how much change the mandibular position. Then after that, of course, the final prosthodontic treatment. Then this is a prosthodontic treatment finish. Okay. And before and after. Yeah, this is a before. But after this treatment, the creaking disappeared. Yeah, good. This is 5 years later, still keep this situation and no creaking. It's functionally pretty okay. The phonetic position, this was also, it was big problem, but after repositioning therapy, the phonetic position is very good, very nice position. So, then osteoarthritic joint, now, this is a big problem. Now we have the international consensus that if overload the condyle, then start the condyle cartilage breakdown, then start osteoarthritic change. This kind of a patient, now we have a problem. This is this 38 years old female patient. Currently, she developed anterior open bite. Okay. Sorry. This is her 8 years ago, she brought her panoramic X-ray. And this is now the situation right now, this 8 years later. Her problem is this 8 year, her condyle was very much destroyed. this kind of kondai destroyed something like this. And this is now a big, big problem. Now let me show you one or two case. This 18 years old, still young patient, but the class 2 open bite case. Her bite is something like this. This is actually secondary open bite, because you can see many facet, the canine and the premolar here. That means she had the bite before, but now slowly the opening anterior bite, because her condylar resorption, osteoarthrotic chain. That's why now the very small condyle. So treatment, this open bite treatment is not difficult, but this kind of case, anyway, we have to provide a very nice the occlusion support here. Therefore, usually we have to make a nice occlusal plane and a nice uprighting here. Anyway, this case, all the teeth are uprighting and the anterior bite is closed. Then this is right after orthodontic treatment, and 2 years after, then 4 years after orthodontic treatment, then we compare the, this is a before and after. Maybe you can see the mandible is a little bit rotate forward, then reposition forward. This kind of change is good for the unloading joint. Therefore, this is before and right after orthodontic treatment finish, then four and a half year after treatment. Maybe you can recognize the condyle morphological change of the condyle. Slowly, I think the remodeling going on. So this is the last case today. Same type of case, the secondary open bite, but her condyle osteoarthrotic change was so severe, very much flattening. Then this case, anyway, also orthodontically treat. Then finish. The 2 years after and the 4 years after orthodontic treatment, the bite is okay, not opening. But interestingly, the condyle morphology is changing, especially the 4 years after the big change of the condyle. I think condylar regeneration start. The recovering the condyle morphology. Yeah, both sides of the condyle. So this kind of condyle adaptational regeneration is possible. Therefore, unloading joint treatment is very, very important in this kind of patient. Okay, my conclusion is the orthodontics is a powerful technique to reconstruct occlusion, especially in PMD patient. Repositioning the mandible and providing occlusal support are very important. From this point of view, the surgical orthodontics and the premolar extraction treatment are not recommended. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. How?
For this very nice lecture, do you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
Okay. Greetings from Vienna, and we do have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
And I would like to ask you some selected questions. May I start with the first one?
Okay.
Please explain the etiology of class 2s with flexed cranial base and flat occlusal plane, as well as class 3s with extended cranial base and very steep occlusal plane. So the question is for the etiology.
Yeah. So this part of the question, it is still more necessary, more research. But for example, class 3 development, flattening occlusal plane and or over eruption of molar, I think one factor is posterior discrepancy. Modern people has posterior part of the crowding, molar crowding. This causes the change the occlusal plane. This is one of the factor. And also, cranial bone not static, it's a dynamic. Therefore, during the growth, the more dynamic balance of cranial bones contribute to change the particle dimension, occlusal plane, mandibular adaptation. Yeah, but anyway, I want to say this part of the real etiology, we need more research.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
So the other question is, what is the criteria or limitation that determines whether the class 2 or class 3 skeletal malocclusion can be treated with the altering the occlusal plane rather than surgical approach or camouflage treatment protocol?
Yeah, always I got this kind of question. But to me, that we should be careful to use the word of camouflage. What is a camouflage? The surgical approach is also camouflage, right? Therefore, I don't like this word. But anyway, whatever the class 2, class 3, to me, actually, no problem. we can treat whatever the skeletal problem without surgery. But of course, the only orthodontic approach, we have limitation, especially for the change of face morphology. If patient want to change their faces, yeah, why not the surgery? But occlusion wise, we can approach to the skeletal malocclusion. It's possible. In the future, if we have a time, I'd like to show you such a case.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Then there is two questions which probably belong together, and maybe you hear it always also very often. It's the one is, what do you think about aligners treatments like Invisalign? Or the other question is, aligner therapy as occlusal covering appliance in mixed dentition. What is your opinion?
Answer is very simple. I hate those appliances because I like to, you know, today I showed this uprighting and you know, the vertical control, occlusal plane control is most important part of the treatment. Aligner or Invisalign. If people want to use this those appliances, I don't care. But try to change occlusal plane or uprighting. We must make a very clear final goal, especially for the function problem. Then, in order to go to our goal, I have no idea using Invisalign type of the appliance use to go to the goal. Therefore, I hate such a appliance. Sorry.
Okay. So, and maybe a last questions. We have many, many more questions, maybe more than 50 questions, but yeah, we don't have the time. So there's a last question. And just to make sure to the participants, we will follow up with the questions in written and then give you the answers to the webpage. But the last two questions would be, are you including the evaluation of cervical vertebrae during the examination of the patient?
Yeah, of course. Our initial diagnosis, we check all the, you know, the muscle or nerve system and the cervical part of the palpation, whatever. Yeah, this is very important diagnostic approach. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Professor Sato, for taking your time and making this wonderful lecture. I would like to thank all my team, also the two translators in Paraguay, in Paris, and Professor Sato in Tokyo. I wish everybody a very nice afternoon, morning, or evening, wherever you are. And thank you very much. See you in one of our future and next visit webinars. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.